Welcome. Welcome to our first service of 2022. I'm not going to say much more. I'm not going to spoil it. I hope you all had a blessed Christmas festive season and happy Christmas, Boxing Day, and all that kind of stuff. And happy Hog Manet. And as I said, this is our first service of, you'll be watching our first service of 2022. And we hope that the year 2022 will be a year that we might actually remember fondly, as opposed to 2020, then 2021. But I don't want to kind of you know, make things worse by kind of bringing it up as however. But this will, you know, we will here at Strathearn, we will continue to. I'm not sure what the situation will be as you actually watch this service as part of the life of our congregation. But we hope that you will have a good start to the year, and I shall leave it at that. As always, I will say thank you to everyone who has been involved in the ensuring that we had a series of services for the festive season. So I will thank you in particular to the congregation and to the choir, who were wonderful parts of the service for Christmas Eve and Boxing Day. And we thank for the gift of music that they shared with us. And we thank for all the support people who ensured that the services were recorded and, you know, bulletins were ready and all that kind of stuff. So as always, you see me on the camera and you see the Ministry for Music, but I'm always reminded, one of my favorite images of church is like, it's a swan. You see the swan swimming majestically on the lake, and I suppose clergy are supposed to like that. I don't think I'm much of a swan. I think sometimes I'm more like a Canada goose. But you see that swimming along, and what you don't see is the feet paddling like heck underneath to keep the whole thing going. And that's often been a very useful image for me in terms of the importance of what's going on in the life of the church, that a whole bunch of people are involved in so many different forms of ministry in the congregation, from outreach, pastoral care, administration, property, finance, the whole, as Paul has so powerfully said, all the parts of the body that make it work. So I thank you for all the work that you did in 2021, and we look forward to your continuing ministry for us in 2022. We just hope that we'll have more opportunity to be doing that ministry in person, and doing that ministry as part, not just in the kind of survival mode, but hopefully in some kind of flourishing mode. So thank you to the body of Christ in action that is Strathearn United Church. Let's just take a moment. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and earth, the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. Our first hymn is "Arise, Your Light Has Come," Voices United 79.
Show forth the glory of your God.
Let us approach God in prayer. God, we gather here to be touched by your light, so it may be a guide unto how we live our lives in your creation. We follow the light of your Son, who shared with us a vision of the world filled with your light, and who invites us to be your light in the world. God, thank you for your faith in us that we can be such a light. Amen. Together, let us share in a new creed. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to live with respect in creation, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus crucified and risen, our judge and our hope, in life, in death, in life beyond death. God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Let us approach God in a time of confession. Jesus did not simply die to save us from our sins. Jesus lived to save us from our sins. His life and teachings show us the way to liberation. But you can't fit all that in a bumper sticker. So we try to boil it down to a formula. Four steps. The Romans Road, John 3:16. And yet the gospel itself, in its eternal scope and scandalous particularity, defies reduction. God, we gather before you in the presence of your light, light that will be with us as we struggle with our brokenness, light that will guide us to that path of healing that begins with our faith in your grace. God, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. God, have mercy. Let the light of God's grace renew us. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our next hymn is In the Darkness Shines the Splendor, Voices United 92.
In the darkness shines a splendor. We share in God's word. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. A reading from the Gospel of John, chapter 1, verses 1 to 14. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into him through him, and without him, not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him. Yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood, or the will of the flesh, or the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Great glad tidings tell, oh come to us, my wife with us, our Lord.
I'm sure we all go through the various rituals of New Year's resolutions and what we're planning to do and new projects and all this kind of stuff. And sometimes they fall through and sometimes they fall by the wayside and end up in the kind of the place of let's not talk about them ever again. One of the things I'm hoping to do this year is revive my interest, or not revive my interest, it's a rather kind of clumsy way of putting it, is to start being involved again in what is, I guess, now known as tabletop role-playing games, which to distinguish them from computer role-playing games. Tabletop role-playing games are the various gaming systems, such as Dungeons and Dragons and all the others that were supposedly all leading us into worshipping false gods and devil worship and all that kind of stuff. I played them a lot when I was a teenager, and they were, I'll be blunt, they were a salvation for me. They allowed me an opportunity to gather with my friends. We had a blast. We played a whole variety of games, Advanced Dungeons and Dragons as it was known then. RuneQuest, Traveller, Middle-earth role-playing, the whole whack of them. These days, there are so many of these supplements that you can role-play anything. You can actually, theoretically, I could even role-play a campaign in biblical times, and it's not sure it'd be too much like work for me. That's not right. The whole point of these games was to allow the players to be part of a different world. Now, often they're quite lazy, these role-playing campaigns. Dungeons and Dragons in particular, I found to be a bit very derivative of like Tolkien stuff and all this kind of thing. Some of the science fiction games were a lot more kind of imaginative because they weren't relying upon a particular, fandom or whatever. But one game in particular that I am planning to become more involved in is a game called RuneQuest. It was a fantasy style role-playing game, but it was very different. It had a complete mythology around it all that was quite different from the usual traditional fantasy. It had elves, it had dwarves and all this kind of stuff, but they were quite different. They were rooted in this world. And something I often muse on, even though in those days I was a non-believer, I was an atheist, I was often drawn to various type of religious imagery. For instance, today's service is actually the reading that we heard from Christine, the Gospel of John. I have a very vivid memory of listening to that reading and being entranced by it. It was on a TV show, and this was when I was still living, this is when I was growing up in Scotland. And at the back of the music, someone was playing Samuel Barber's Adagio for strings. And it's this very beautiful piece of music. And having that played with this reading of the Gospel of John, it deeply moved me. And it still does. I still hear it now and again. I remember the time wanting to record it so I could listen. And as I was an atheist. It's like it had no religious significance to me. And then RuneQuest had one of its core parts of its mythology was what was referred to as the quest of the Lightbringers. And I won't go into we don't have time. I do have to give a sermon. But at the heart of the quest of the Lightbringers was a quest of a collection of the deities of the RuneQuest world, Orlanf, Isaris, Lankormai, Shalan Aroi. I rattle all these names and they're absolutely meaningless to you, but these were a group of deities who wanted to restore light to the universe, and they engage in a quest, and in this quest they are each confronted by their failure to live up to their mandate as a deity. So Shalan Aroi, who is the goddess of healing, cannot heal a wound. Isaris, who's the deity of traveling, cannot follow the path. Lankormai cannot find, and such and such. But it's through that moment of confronting their failure that the quest will continue, that they become more aware of who they are, their strengths, their weaknesses. And in that moment of failure, the light is restored. And that really, for some reason, that really sunk into me, and it still does. And so when I think of light as an imagery, and when I think of light as an imagery of my faith, and I listen to the reading of the Gospel of John, I have this vision of the light that guides us through our failures. The light that guides us in those moments of the darkness of our lives. When we are confronted with the legacy of the past, as I shared earlier in 2021, I talked about my background of being an adult child of an alcoholic and all the other bits and pieces, all those things in our lives that are struggles. And learning to confront the weaknesses, the brokenness, those moments when we weren't able to do what we had hoped to do, those moments when we thought we had failed, and know that the light was still there. And for me, that is what it means to have light in faith. You know, that's what I hear in the gospel, you know, in this reading. And that's my own interpretation. And, you know, other people have more kind of grandiose, like the struggle of light against darkness, which is one of those, for me, actually quite unfortunate understandings of dualism, the light against the dark, because there's only going to be one winner. I've never cared for dualism. I grew up in the Cold War. The West is good. The Warsaw Pact is bad. Yeah, right. You know, evil was on both sides, people, and we now know that quite clearly. The West may have supported human rights within the United States, Canada, Germany, whatever. Certainly had no interest in Central America. But because we were good and the Soviet Union was bad, and it was bad, you know, don't get me wrong, I'm not going to defend what was going on there either. There was a clash that there could only be one winner. I mean, the reality was, if we actually did clash, there'd be no winners. We would have destroyed ourselves. Even now, we have this dualism in our, you know, right against wrong and whatever. There is, you know, one side will, you know, victory at all costs. We see this particularly in the United States. We're also seeing it in the UK. There's no room for middle ground. You know, there's no room for an understanding that the light shines on all of us. If you are good, you do not have exclusive access to the light. And just because you've called the people in the dark, they actually are just as entitled to be touched by the light as you are. The light shines on all of us. What we hear in the reading from John, what I hear in the reading from John, is an invitation to follow that light, to begin a new journey through life, to walk in the presence of God, seeing the world as God sees it, that light that shines on everyone. And everyone that is shaped by God's love, and that we are a living witness to that love. God does not create evil. God does not create evil people. They happen for a variety of reasons. We all have darkness within us. It's you know, there's no one who is pure in faith. No one. Even Jesus himself was not pure in faith. Jesus himself struggled with the darkness. That's why he turns up at the river of the Jordan to ask for repentance. He knows that, like us, he is flawed, he is broken, and yet he yearns for the light of God that will guide him into new life, new hope, new life. And when Jesus reaches out to God, that new light will take him to a place where he will shine that light on others. The challenge with such a vision of the light is it doesn't let us off the hook. If we adhere to this idea of the cosmic struggle, life against, you know, light against dark and all that malarkey, then we can do things and justify them because we are the forces of good. That when the West engaged in its acts of evil in Central America and other places, it was justified because we had to save the world from communism. Did we burn down your village? Ah, that's too bad. At least we saved it from communism. I'm sure that was really meaningful to the people who died. At least they knew they had died to save the world from communism. But that is what happens when you get into that mindset of good against evil, light against dark. You start to see the other side as something that needs to be destroyed. Something that needs to be ground into the dirt because it's in the way of your vision of being right. And you forget that the light of God shines on everyone. I think that's one of the reasons why that path is quite difficult for us, because we'd rather it be easy. That we'd rather, you know, yeah, we're good and they're not, and so let's just get on with it. It can, that vision of dualism, that vision of the conflict, it's an appealing path to follow because it frees us from reflecting on our own personal struggles. To confront the brokenness in ourselves, to confront the darkness in ourselves, is difficult. We don't want to see those parts of ourselves. We don't want to know that we are broken, that we have darkness. Because first of all, we might have to do something about it, and that's difficult. It's always, you know, one of the things I always struggle with my library of personal flaws. What one will I use now? What one will I justify with? And then that little voice of conscience, that annoying pain in the neck, will say, no, Sandy, your personal flaws are an explanation, not a justification. Learn the difference. Yeah, I don't want to. I prefer the justification. It's so much easier. Woe is me, I'm so sad. It is an explanation. The darkness is there. And we who are followers of the light of God are given an opportunity to walk into that darkness, preferably in the company of others who are there to support and care for us, who understand us, and encounter the wonder that God will love us. Whatever we've done, whatever brokenness, whatever darkness we struggle with, God will love us. And in the light of God, we are shown a path to face our darkness, to face our brokenness, and move towards the light. Sometimes that light's not much. Sometimes it's like a candle. But it's all we need. One of the most stirring moments in Lord of the Rings is when Samwise, after in this time of great struggle, he has fought the mighty spider Shelob, and he is struggling to move forward, and he holds the light of Erendil, this wondrous piece of jewelry that holds the star, and as Tolkien so vividly describes it, he says that the brown, trusty hand of Sam is lit up because of the sign of his loyalty, his commitment, his willingness to do what he could to serve his master, to continue the quest, to do what must be done, and the light shines brightly. Sam had confronted a whole variety of struggles in this moment, and in this light, he sees a way forward. That is the light that I follow, the light of faith. there are moments when I do struggle with that vision of light. I want that light to clear away all those folks I consider wrong and bad and whatever. And then I have to remember I'm probably just as bad as them in my own way. You know, this terrible joke, because I do have a dark sense of humor. And this picture pops up in my timeline, you know, because Facebook knows I have a dark sense of humor. And it shows this picture of this man whose hand is absolutely covered in black oil. And it says, "That's your hand when someone touches your sense of humor." And I'm like, okay, I don't need to see that anymore. The darkness is there. The light is there. As we heard in the reading from Genesis, they are both part of the creation of God. There is light and there is darkness. We do not live in eternal daylight. We live in that combination of day. And as we know here in Edmonton at this time of year, there's a lot more darkness than there is light. But in that darkness, the light awaits us. Whatever we tell ourselves, or whatever the world tries to tell us, we are always worth loving. God loves us, and God hopes that we will love ourselves. And as we love ourselves, we will love one another. This is the good news of Christ Jesus to all people mired in despair because they believe that God has turned away from them for whatever reason. Even from their own actions, even if they themselves believe that they have committed darkness, that they have been part of the brokenness of the world, and if they have been convinced by themselves, if not by others, that they deserve to be rejected by God, this is never the case. And it never will be. God will never reject us. What is required of us is faith in God's love. To reject the brokenness, the darkness of the world that has shaped us in such a way that we believe we have been rejected by God. To turn away from that path. To see the light. To follow it. To see that God is with us. And in that moment, maybe once more we will see the world as God sees it, as something filled with love, care, and compassion, and accept God's invitation to be part of that light. Amen. Let us come before God in prayer. God, grant us the serenity to accept the things we cannot change, the courage to change the things we can, and the wisdom to know the difference. God, we gather before you at the start of a new year. We give thanks. We give thanks for your presence in the year that has passed. Your presence among us revealed in expected and unexpected ways. We give thanks for your hope in us that we will be your light in the world as we give thanks to the people in our lives that are your light in our lives as we bring these names to you in silence. God, in this time of new beginnings, we pray that you will be with us as we face the challenges of this world. We continue to deal with the reality of COVID-19, the onset of new variants. Our healthcare system continues to face these challenges, our education system faces these challenges. The whole infrastructure of our modern society struggles with these challenges. And we yearn for leadership. Leadership that will guide us through these difficult days, that will reassure us that things are going to work out, while ensuring that we do what we must to create places of safety. God, we pray for your guidance in these days. We pray that we will continue to be faithful to your vision of care and compassion for one another. We pray for all who struggle with the reality of oppression, oppression in whatever form it takes, political, religious, social, economic, sexuality, faith. We pray for those whose voices cry out for justice, who yearn for better days. We pray for all who struggle with uncertainty. What will their year be like? What will the world be like? God, we pray. And in this time of new beginnings, God, we pray that you will be with us as we face the challenges of the world. Let us accept your invitation to be signs of hope in these days, to share your vision of a better world and invite others to join us to make it a reality. Let it begin with prayer as we bring to God the prayers of our hearts. For those who we know who struggle with illness of the mind, body, and spirit. For those who mourn the loss of loved ones. For those who yearn for connection. In silence, God, we bring these names to you. Amen. Our closing hymn is "Will You Come and See the Light," Voices United 96. Of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under the bushel basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to God in heaven. Amen.